A very good morning and welcome to the 19th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have apologies from Katie Clark. We have had a change in committee membership and I would like to welcome Bob Doris to the committee, who replaces Gordon MacDonald, and Ros McCall, who replaces Miles Briggs, and to thank Gordon and Miles for their valued contribution to the committee. Our first item of business today is to invite Bob Doris and Ros McCall to declare any relevant interests. So can I ask Bob?
Yeah, thank you, Vera, and it's great to be back on this committee. There are no relevant interests to declare, but of course, as always, I would draw those watching who are interested to my register of interests anyway.
Okay, thank you. And Ros?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much indeed. I'm really glad to be here. Thank you very much. This is my first committee, so it's nice to be here. So thank you for the warm welcome. I also have no declaration of interest to announce, but equally happy for anyone to look if they want to.
Okay, thanks, Ros. The Parliament has agreed that only members of the Scottish National Party are actually eligible for nomination as Deputy Convener of this committee. So I would like to nominate Bob Doris for this role. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. Therefore, I would like to welcome Bob as Deputy Convener. So our next item of business for today is a decision to take agenda items 5 and 6 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Our next item is an evidence session as part of our inquiry into addressing child poverty through parental employment. Before summer recess, we held a series of evidence sessions on childcare, education, employability and fair and family-friendly working. Today we're going to focus on transport. I welcome to the meeting our panel, Paul Finch, Strategy Manager, NESH Trans and Vice Chair for Transportation on the Society of Chief Officers of Transportation in Scotland. Mick Hogg, Regional Organiser, National Union of Rail, Maritime and Transport Workers, also known as the RMT. And Paul White, Director, Confederation of Passenger Transport, CPT Scotland. Thank you all for accepting our invitation. And I would just like to make a few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. So can you please wait until I or a member asking the question, say your name before speaking. Don't feel you have to answer all or every single question, and I have nothing new to add to what's been said by others, then that's perfectly okay as well. Members online, please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphone on before you start to speak. And you can indicate with an R in the chat box in Zoom if you wish to come in on a question as well. And can I ask everyone to keep questions and answers as concise as possible? So I'm going to invite our members now to ask questions in turn. And first of all, I'm going to ask Ros to come in on question one. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener. I would like to ask both the Pauls, if that's okay, but Mick, if you want to come in at a point, then I'm happy with that. What are some of the key challenges in delivering the vision of a national transport strategy? And basically, I'm also wanting to know how that's going to work in a long-term process, not just as an immediate issue, but how is it going to work in the long term? Thank you.
Okay, I'll commence. Thank you very much for the question. The overall vision for the transport strategy has been fairly well and clearly set out in National Transport Strategy 2, and I think across the industry there is a widespread support for the objectives and commitment within that. Transport Scotland then went on to deliver a Strategic Transport Project, STPR2, Strategic Transport Project Review 2, which set out some of the strategic priorities for delivery of transport thereafter. What we're now seeing is how that is then being put into action in the ground, both in the indications for the short to the medium and long term. I think what is clear is that revenue funding is a clear challenge for the full implementation of the vision they set out in the strategy. Sometimes there is a constraint on the sometimes ability to change or the commitment to change long-held practices around how the transport system is operated. There are some real challenges to see how things can be overdone. And also there are competing pressures with the local authority level to sustain some of those changes that we might want to seek to bring about. Perhaps bus franchising might be one example of there where some of the risk is transferred to the local authority. And I think that a local authority level, when they're also facing pressures from health, education, other objectives at the moment, I think that is a constraint on that ability to fully achieve the objectives that have been set out in the National Transport Strategy. So there's some of the headwinds that seem to be slowing the delivery of those objectives.
I'll echo a lot of what Paul says without repeating it. I think the NTS vision and objectives are all admirable. We're all pushing the same direction and they still stand. The document was largely created pre-COVID, so post-COVID there are challenges about the delivery of that in terms of, and I'll speak for my sector, the bus sector, usage is down. I mean, that is also true for rail, but you know, patronage is down. The patterns of travel are changing. The operational costs have increased. While we're still seeing car use and congestion reach the same levels as it was pre-COVID, which is a real challenge for bus operation in terms of making your services reliable, affordable, punctual. So we also face challenges, and we've seen that maybe in the press recently with the launch of the low emission zones and Aberdeen's bus gates, that there is pushback on things that may... The environmental benefit of it, or the environmental agenda, was maybe stronger at a point, whereas the cost of living crisis has now come in to play, so that people look at these measures and consider, is this limiting my access? Is this going to affect my... Is it going to hit me in the pocket? I need to buy a new car. And so is the political will there at the local authority level to introduce the kind of measures that would really free bus from congestion and allow more and better bus services? Is that there present?
Okay, thank you.
40. That's our vision, our concern. We actually believe, RMT believe, that transport is a very important transportation model in order for people to actually get to work. And we believe that with more investment and even the scrapping of peak fares, because we believe that that's an added tax on the working man and the working woman. So the quicker we see a scrapping of peak fares and making a railway more affordable, I think that would be a step in the right direction.
Thank you.
Okay, can I just come in and ask a question on the National Transport Strategy's priorities are obviously wide-ranging and include tackling inequalities. So to what extent is tackling poverty, including child poverty, a consideration in the specific policies set out in this latest delivery plan? And if I can bring in Paul, first of all, and then if Mick and Paul White, shall I say there's two Pauls, so it's confusing. Can I know on that as well? Thank you.
I think traditionally the delivery of transport systems in Scotland have been based around an economic model, very much focused on an explicit cost-benefit model, pounds in, pounds out. And it is only relatively recently that it has been more... I think the child poverty and inequalities element has been there implicitly, but I think it is only in the last few years that there has been a far more explicit assessment of where those assessments come in around the equalities impact assessments we're now seeing undertaken across the sector, health equalities impact assessments as well. And they are perhaps coming in more so on the big policy measures and the priority measures now. So historically... implicit, in the background, more focused on finance and economics, because that's the way transport systems had been historically developed. Increasingly and specifically since the last 3 or 4 years, greater and more explicit, but it's still an increasing level of bringing it to the fore.
Thanks, Paul. Mick, do you want to come in on that? Thanks.
Yes, thank you. Obviously, from an RMT perspective, there's been various reports that have established the link between transport and employment, inequality, poverty. For instance, research published in 2021 by Transport Scotland found that people on low incomes, transport was a vital part of life, and public transport use was influenced by three factors: affordability, accessibility, and individual household circumstances. So I keep referencing the affordability because that's a big issue as far as the RMTs are concerned, you know, because we found out as a result of the pandemic about getting people back to using a railway, that we need to actually not only encourage but actually support people by using Scotland's trains, because transport, if we're serious about, like, say, the climate agenda action, then I think using our trains is a very important model to actually encourage and support.
Okay, thank you. Paul, do you want to come in on that? Thanks.
Yep, certainly. I agree with the other two panellists there. Buses are an enabler for many government objectives, and that is clear from the National Transport Strategy. In fact, there's a diagram in there about the virtuous cycle of bus. If you improve bus, it will bus speeds, you will lower bus fares, it becomes possible to increase the network, and so on. So there are steps through the actions of the NTS that should help tackle inequality. There are other, also schemes like the under free travel for the under 22 scheme, which is specifically designed to tackle that kind of affordability issue for young people. And I think, you know, you see that in the First Minister's statement from earlier this year about affordability, availability, accessibility, and the role bus can play in that.
Okay, thank you. I believe Ros wants to come back in. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks. Mick, you raised a very point with your three points there. So I just want to come back on that, because you're talking about affordability, but individual circumstances. And I don't know if you've got information from your members as to what the balance is on there. Is affordability the main concern, or is it just doesn't quite fit with the way that their lives are? So I'm just trying to get an idea of the balance between the two.
I think affordability is crucial, you know, because it's costing working class people, a man or a woman, an absolute fortune in order to actually get to their place of work. You know, you're talking about thousands of pounds, and we just feel that affordability really needs to be top of the agenda so far as the Scottish Government is concerned, by supporting, you know, as I said earlier, you know, by scrapping the peak fares, you know, because we see that as an added tax on hard-working families at the end of the day.
OK, so just to give it a wee round-up so that I've got it, because I'm new to all this, but if we could fix the affordability, the other issues would kind of solve themselves?
Yes.
OK,
yes.
Thank you.
Okay, Paul White would like to come in. Thanks.
Yes. Can I come in and offer a slightly different perspective from my sector in terms of affordability is crucial, and we should be looking at how we manage that for bus users and potential bus users. But for us, it's one element of a package that you have to deliver. So if I take the under 22 scheme, you can give every young person under 22's card so they can travel for free by bus. But if there's not a bus that they can access, if there's no bus available, then there's no point to the card. So yes, these schemes can encourage usage, but only if it's part of a package of measures that also looks at the availability and accessibility of services.
OK, thank you. I think Marie would like to come in now. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks for your time this morning. It's estimated that a third of the population are entitled to free bus travel, focusing on the older people, young people and disabled people. Do you think that's the kind of right groups to focus on? And I'll pop it to Paul White first.
From my perspective, it is for government to decide what who should receive that benefit. From my perspective, it is then for we look to ensure that the scheme is fair for users and for the operators who are asked to provide the scheme. So to extending free travel is fine as long as the scheme to deliver that, the concessionary travel schemes, operate on the basis that operators should be no better or worse off for participation, which is built into the scheme. So if you extend the people who are eligible, you extend the budget, and that's where there's maybe an issue when we've got a tight financial settlement. And as these schemes can generate good increases in usage, and I think we're going to see an evaluation report in the first year of the under 22 scheme very, very soon. It's imminent, and that will probably point to that. But again, to really make the most of these schemes, to make them worth the hundreds of millions that government spend on them, you really need to look at it alongside providing a reliable and accessible network of services.
Thanks for that, Paul. Mick, do you have any kind of comments?
Well, first and foremost, we don't have any bus members as such. We are bus members south of the border, but from a Scottish perspective, we don't have any bus members. But certainly from an RMT perspective, my view is it's a great opportunity for young people, because it allows young people to see more of the country and travel. If that opportunity wasn't there, then young people would be restricted in terms of travel. So I think it's a great opportunity and it's welcomed.
Obviously, the concession, you know, from SPT, from obviously Rail. Paul?
Yeah, thanks for the questions. The questions about the balance of where have we got the concession balance right? I think it's always important to go back to what are we trying to achieve with this, and is the government actually trying to achieve the benefit for those with low incomes? Well, then that might suggest possibly worth assessing moving from a more targeted concession scheme to as opposed to a universal scheme, but obviously that has drawbacks as well. The over 60s, concession. Obviously, people between 60 and 65 are still working as well, so that's possibly a consideration, but obviously that's a historical decision as well. I think there could be things that are better targeted at low-income families, because there doesn't seem to be that at the moment. And I guess another anomaly across Scotland, and I know there are exceptions, is this parity across modes as well, whereas there's a lot of concession offered in the bus sector, which is welcomed, but there are examples across Scotland where rail is that missing link. There are people geographically disadvantaged because they have a rail station and not necessarily a bus station. It seems a bit bizarre. And also perhaps you go to the Northern Isles as well, where people will be using the ferry services almost as a proxy bus service. But again, they don't have that entitlement as well, and they're disadvantaged due to geography, not due to circumstance, which, again, seems to be a couple of anomalies in the current system, which may be worth considering. But obviously, one has to consider that in the context of the objectives you're trying to achieve as a government, and also the revenue that is available as well as wider political considerations.
Thanks, Dr. Paul. Hand back to convener.
Ros, if you'd like to come in.
Yes, I would happily. I'm sorry, I'm writing so many notes. I'm not quite as organised as I should be. My apologies. okay. Yeah, here we are. Okay. The Fair Fares Review is currently underway. What would you like to see recommended in terms of concessional travel? Or concessionary travel, sorry. My apologies. And I think I'm going to have to ask all three of you again, as me being in the new situation. I'm just going to go for all three, because the more information I get, the better.
If that's okay, just work on there. I guess in the headlines there's been two elements to Fares Fare Review. One, and Mick has very kindly talked about the peak fares removal, as well as 6-month trial. One wonders whether that is long enough to properly evaluate that in terms of, well, is that long enough to assess the changes that might happen, and also then to make a decision as well, what you're going to do about it after you have that evaluation. It appears to me to be a very short period of time in order to assess something. So although it is
simplification of the rail fares network, I think everybody would agree, would be broadly welcomed. It is complex and, again, geographically varied across the country as well. Other aspects of the fares fare review have been, I think, one of the, I think Paul said in his written submission, opaque. We know that there is a desire to sort of take a step back and look at the funding distribution and the revenue aspects of the different aspects of the public sector, the public transport sector across Scotland. But to date, local authorities have been relatively... It hasn't been shared with us to date around those things. I think in terms of what we would like to see, I think I'll refer back to my previous answer, which is about, well, we want to see how the money that has been distributed to public transport sector as a whole is actually meeting the government's objectives and also responding to the key needs that we know we have across Scotland at the moment. So I would like to see that as an outcome, and I'd like to see some more transparency about how that process has been going about, because to date, members haven't seen that transparency.
OK, thanks. As far as RMT is concerned, we would like to see a fair balance at the end of the day. We believe that there's not enough investment in Scotland's railway. The investment should allow accessibility for all. We believe that some of the ideas, suggestions that's been put forward by ScotRail and Transport Scotland, and to a degree the Scottish Government, needs a review, particularly the booking office issue. We believe that the booking office issue programme is inextricably linked to antisocial behaviour within Scotland's trains. We believe that the issue of antisocial behaviour is getting worse. It's not getting any better. And to even suggest that closing booking offices and ticket offices and even stations and having unstaffed stations, then the money that's actually been invested in Scotland's trains really begs the question in terms of accessibility for all, particularly if you take the most vulnerable people within society and disabled people. And I would just like to quote a piece, if you just bear with me. It's clear that action is required from the Scottish Government to improve safety of women and girls when travelling by public transport. Research published by Transport Scotland in March 2023 found a consensus from women and girls of all ages that being in spaces that were staffed or had staff presence made women feel safer, and that women were more comfortable if ticket offices were open and staffed, especially after later at night. The report went on to recommend that the Scottish Government explore increasing staff presence on public transport. We believe that the Scottish Government needs to prioritise acting on this recommendation. So the investment is welcome, but we certainly believe that investment needs to be prioritised. Thank you.
I'll make two comments on concessions, and then we bring that into the Fair Fares Review. The first on concessions, there's certainly value in these schemes, but they are hundreds of millions, one, a bugbear of mine is that often in terms of bus spend, that is regarded as support for the bus sector, whereas operators are compelled to provide a service for the government. So it's essentially buying a product. If you buy a loaf from Tesco, you don't say you're subsidising Tesco, you're buying a product. So in those terms, that's an issue with concessions for us. Within the Fair Fares Review, and the only sort of visible outcome of the review so far is the peak rail fares in pilot. What are the objectives of the schemes? I would say that with the under 22 scheme for bus, you probably saw abstraction from rail to bus. People who travel, young people who travel by rail, move to bus. And with the trial of the removal of peak fares, you'll see some commuters who travel by bus now move to rail because they'll find that the better value proposition. But what you are not really affecting is the amount of people who use car. The data suggests that if one of your objectives is to look at it from an environmental benefit or shifting people onto sustainable modes for the longer term, is the money that's spent in it worth the investment? So in terms of the wider Fair Fares review, I think in the point Paul made about looking at overall transport spend, I would welcome a look at that. Bus and rail are on the same side, essentially, of sustainable transport. Bus in Scotland is about 79% of all public transport trips. But the budget for bus, and there's many reasons for that, there's lots of expensive things to do with rail, but the budget for bus is a fraction of the budget for rail, whereas we carry far more people. So looking at the entire transport spend and looking where you can generate the most value that doesn't just give people subsidised fares, but actually looks at how do you make buses and trains better, that would be worthwhile.
Thank you.
I would think Jeremy wants to come in on a supplementary.
Yeah, thank you and good morning, everybody. I suppose I should declare I have a concessionary bus pass, so due to my disability. But I'm interested, Paul, in that last point you were making in regard to how much the bus companies get per journey. In regard to if you use your disabled pass or your younger person's pass. Is that figure going up in regard to the amount of money the bus company runs? And my understanding is that it's the calculation for it can sometimes disadvantage certain bus routes because they don't stop enough or they travel further. Is that something that you would like looked at again? Or are we at a place where the bus companies can make it work?
Thank you. We're actually in the beginning stages of another review of the concessionary models that underpin both the elder and disabled person scheme and the younger person scheme, and that will impact on the budgets for the schemes for the next financial year and the rates that operators receive. There's a science to it. It's a complex one, which involves looking at what would happen in the absence of the scheme. Is the scheme generating trips, which is a benefit to the operator? So you have to consider that. What discounts would a user of the scheme use? Because they wouldn't keep buying single tickets if they were using it more than once a day. So you look at discount factors, generation, cost trends. There's a science that goes into looking at what should be the correct budget for a scheme and what the reimbursement rate should be. However, it's true that we've gone from 73.6% when the scheme launched in about 2007 to 56.8%. It has historically gone down, so hopefully we do not see that this year. And it does, as you rightly point out, if you're running a route which serves pockets of the community where it's largely people who use that product, if they were paying full fare, you would get a certain amount. And if they're using a concessionary card, you're getting 56.8% of that fare. So in terms of making the business case, making the service cover its costs, essentially, it can make it more challenging.
I wonder if I can just go back to Mick's point about the closing of stations and of an unmanning or person of stations. Again, just in regard to what response you've had back in regard to that, particularly for people with disability, that if you arrive at a station and there's nobody there, how are they meant to cope if they need help? Has that been discussed about what in practice are people meant to do?
First things first, the consultation has just closed. It closed, as I understand it, last Friday. And the response that we've had so far is just under 800,000 of a response. That's to the national campaign, which Scotland's also involved with the cross border. We've actually had an absolute overwhelming response from the members of the public, particularly the elderly and the disabled and the vulnerable, because they obviously see and welcome rail stations being staffed, and the actual thought of, like say, no staff being at the stations are it just it's a recipe for absolute disaster as far as women is concerned, young girls are concerned, you know, and you know, we would obviously strongly suggest, recommend to the Transport Secretary, who's actually been sitting on the Transport Focus findings for almost 2 years, and this is now the fourth Transport Secretary, and neither the Transport Secretary have actually come clean in terms of what they actually intend doing with the Transport Focus findings, and we would strongly recommend that the Transport Secretary, Fiona Hislop, comes clean and rules out any cuts.
Thank you, Camilla.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to bring in James, who's joining us remotely. Before I ask him to come in, James, there's a slight shadow on your camera at the moment. Is there any way you can move your camera?
No, I don't know where it's coming from. I tried earlier on to get rid of it. I think it must have something to do with the camera on my computer. I'll see if I can get it sorted at a later date, but I kind of do it just now, Colette.
Okay. Do you want to just come in then, James? Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Now, if we can go back to what the committee meeting's meant to be about. I mean, the issue that's just been discussed is a very important issue. But I don't think that talk about the Cabinet Secretary coming clean on something when we haven't come out with a position yet as yet is appropriate. And I certainly don't think it's appropriate when we're talking about this subject matter here. But I will ask the witnesses, and I'll start with Paul Finch. Do witnesses have a view on the bus fare cap currently operating in England? And do you think such a scheme would be suitable for Scotland?
Thank you for the question. In urban areas, at the moment, some of the bus operators do operate a tap and a cap system, where there is a maximum amount you pay daily. That is a voluntary system which has been brought in by some operators. I think in urban areas, there is a potential for that to work quite nicely. My question then would be, my question to myself almost would be, how might that work for some of the longer rural distance routes? In the northeast of Scotland, we have people coming in from Peterhead and Fraserburgh, and there is obviously a different fare and a cost implication for the bus operators and coach operators, where you have that mix of inter-urban or rural bus services as opposed to a reasonably compact and well-defined urban network, which often operates on a different model. So I think if that was to come in Scotland, then that would be something that would have to be considered in terms of ensuring that it worked appropriately for all. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Paul White, would you like to come in?
Yes, thank you. Yes, I agree with a lot of what Paul was saying there in terms of the fare cap currently in operation in England has seen some increased use, but I think the data suggests that's more use from existing passengers rather than generating a great deal of new passengers. And as Paul points out, the two major factors in looking at a fare structure would be the costs, and the two largest costs for an operator are fuel and drivers' hours. So a longer service, a rural service, it generates more cost to operate, and so finding a cap that suits the entirety of Scotland and the different travel patterns is a challenge. We've managed it in England. The other observation I would make is actually from Germany, where they introduced a cap on their travel scheme. I don't have the exact. I think it's a monthly all travel scheme. They introduced a very discounted rate, and then at a later stage increased it. So it was still much less than the original offering, but a good jump up from the first level. And there was a lot of pushback. So once you establish a scheme like that, it's very difficult to move off it and say to somebody, your fare that you've now grown used to is going to double when we remove the cap. So there are challenges to it, and I think if you're looking at the amount of money such a scheme would cost to launch and the universality of that benefit, there may be better uses for that money.
Okay, thanks for that. I see that you say that they've got it in England, but it's voluntary, which means obviously there were some areas will have it, some areas don't, so there's a kind of postcode effect where some might be benefiting. But see how you said that the cap went from here to there, right? There was a jump in the cap. Would that be because if it's based on past journeys, as it is in England, then you're getting it when there was in principle, in theory anyway, you're getting them in smaller numbers are taking place. When there's an increase in numbers, you're still getting the same amount as the previous journeys, so it's less per head, so you'd have to raise the cap.
If I try and follow if people in England who are currently facing a £2 cap and then it raises to £2.50, is this the idea which is going to happen? Government has to cover the costs between the actual operation costs and the £2 level. I'll need to get you to... could you ask that again?
No, it's fine. Basically, what I was saying was that if you're basing it in past journeys, then what you're doing is you're basing it at the bottom level because you're hoping to increase your partners, your passenger numbers, which would mean that there's more people getting that cap, which would mean there'd be more cost eventually to either the provider or else they'd have to raise the cap, as they've already done in England, and I suspect we'd have to do it again.
Well, I think I get your point now that, yes, I mean, that essentially you can be a victim of your own success in terms of if a scheme generates greater use and government is paying X per journey, then it increases. So these schemes, as they become more successful, cost government more, yes, definitely.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to bring in Mick Hogg for...
Ros come in with a supplementary. Apologies for interrupting you there, sorry.
Thank you, Convener. My apologies, James. Sorry about that. No, it was just on that last point, Paul, if I could. I believe Lothian Buses are doing something similar as to what's happening down south with a £4.80 daily cap on their buses. Is that something that is working, do you know? Is that something that is a model that could work, even though it's slightly different? But is that something that has been taken into consideration? And what's your thoughts on that?
Absolutely, that's probably the future of ticketing. And I think the use of the word cap here. So in the English scheme, that's a national offering of providing a set fare level for your journey. It's a £2 cap on your journey. What Lothian is offering is a point at which. Yeah, so if you keep buying singles or whatever, you're never going to be above this value. It's similar to, it's similar in London as well. Capping that at a level, an operator level, is a fantastic offer to the passenger, and we're seeing uptake of that, and we'll see operators probably extend those schemes across Scotland. And the next challenge, which will probably be one for the National Smart Ticketing Advisory Board, which is being set up, is how do we look to make those kind of schemes multi-operator schemes? Because currently each operator, Lothian, will set their cap based on their particular situation, whereas a first or a stagecoach might have a different cap. So how do you provide a regional fare structure where there's that kind of capping available?
But that's more plausible than the other capping scheme that you were talking about.
Well, essentially, if you were looking to... That's purely commercial, what Lothian is doing. There's no government funding for that. They're providing a commercial offering, and operators are providing a commercial offering. One of the outputs of the Fair Fares Review was, we think that a daily cap should be this amount, X amount, and it's lower than the current cap offered by Lothian, then you would have to see, well, that might be an expense to government. Are you going to fund that? Are you going to, if you're saying this is the cap, but it doesn't meet costs, is there going to be a cost to that?
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. And apologies again, James.
No, can I just clarify the cap on that? Is that for one journey or is it for multiple journeys?
The cap as it's offered in England, is on a per journey, so no journey is going to cost you more than £2. And the Lothian offering is... Lothian's the total for the day. So if you buy four singles, you're not going to be charged four singles, you're only going to be charged at a cap level, which would be less than four singles.
Okay.
For example.
Thanks for clarifying that, and I'll now let James back in. Thank you.
No more. Thank you to both of you for that. Mick Hogg, what's the scope for integrating concessionary travel entitlements across different modes of transport, and what do you think are some of the barriers to achieving this?
The concessionary travel, as I understand it, doesn't go far enough as far as RMTs are concerned. We obviously have been campaigning as a trade union for a long time to make the concessionary travel more wider, to cover more people. You know, we certainly feel that similar to what's taking place within the buses in terms of young people should be applicable also to the actual trains. So that's certainly our view as far as that issue is concerned.
Thanks for that, Mick. But, can you give me, what do you think are some of the barriers to achieving this?
Some of the barriers, I think, a more working relationship with ScotRail Transport Scotland and ScotRail Weight Holdings. We certainly feel that there's a lot of bureaucracy involved when it comes to, running Scotland's railway. We feel if there was less bureaucracy, we feel that the more progress would actually be made in terms of running Scotland's trains.
Hey, thanks for that. Can I ask Paul Finch to give me his view on this, please?
Thank you for the question. It is possible, because there are rail concessions in the SPT area that go wider than the national concept, go wider than what's available nationally as well. I think historically, if not currently, Fife has a scheme as well. I'm not entirely sure of that one, apologies, but definitely in SBT. So it is possible. So one then thinks, well, why is it not happening? And then one might think, well, is the ambition there to change something that's a status quo? Or is that available in terms of the revenue funding available for the whole transport sector? Would probably be the main barriers that would be presented. There would be no doubt technical issues, but the fact that it's been done in one area, in a particular area, seems to me that it is possible. So then it's a case of, well, is that the best use of the revenue that's available for the transport system in order to achieve that? And again, is that then achieving the overall objectives that we're trying to achieve, which is about getting children and alleviating child poverty and getting parents assisting people into work? We know affordability is one thing, but then availability and household circumstances are other things as well. So I guess there is that balance. I would also say across modes, and I made that point before, different parts of Scotland have got different access to different transport systems as well. So again, that might have to be considered.
Yeah, thanks for that. And Paul White, would you like to come in if you had to say in this one?
Again, I'd probably say that it would be for government to consider whether they want to extend concessions to other modes. I would point that rail fares are already heavily subsidised by Scottish Government. ScotRail would be able to provide you with the committee with the exact figures, but I think the subsidy to rail fares currently, which universally is probably greater than the money that's spent in the concessionary fares schemes for bus. So that gives you an idea of the quantum we're talking about. So extending free fares to groups within rail would have an impact, would have a huge financial cost. It would also probably have an impact on bus use. So looking at that, holistically looking at the impact of these schemes across all modes, I think is very important. I know we're asking the government to monitor the impact on bus of the removal of peak rail fares, just so that we understand there are consequences for these for other things, and if that means that services no longer run for certain areas or for bus because people have gone to rail, what do we do about that holistically, which hopefully is something that's covered in the Fair Fares Review.
Yeah, right. Thanks very much. Thank you, Camille.
Okay, thanks, James. I'm now going to bring in Bob Doris. Thanks.
Thanks, Convener. Can I put on record that I want to thank Paul Finch, who brought us back to the focus of this inquiry, which is child poverty and parental employment. And I absolutely get that all three witnesses have been talking about affordability and the quality of the service and safety of female travellers, a whole variety of things, but the focus of this inquiry is child poverty and parental employment. And there's lots of factors in relation to that, in relation to transport. And I need to put on the record, again, Convener, that comes into, we could do more on this if we didn't have a national minimum wage, but with a real living wage. That would make fares more affordable. I'd also say that 69% of children living in poverty are in working households, where at least one person is working, and that 80,000 children in Scotland are impacted by the two-child cap, benefits cap, by the UK government. Can I just ask briefly, before I get substantive questions here, Convener, whether the witnesses believe that ending the two-child cap and moving from a national minimum wage to a real living wage would be a substantive move to making transport more affordable for parents trying to get into work or to get more hours within their working day? Mr Hogg, perhaps.
Quick answer, Bob, yes. And to make the opportunity, let's say, more possible. And, you know, like I said, the highlighting of the cost levels of provision can be barriers when taking up employment, you know. So giving the families and young people that opportunity to actually travel with reduced fares or even free fares, I think that would actually go a long, long way in addressing child poverty within Scotland.
Okay, Mr Finch, I don't know if you'd be drawing on this, but I wouldn't be doing my job properly as an MSP whose constituents are directly impacted by this if I didn't ask this question. Would this make a difference to affordability in transport, Mr Finch?
I feel unwilling to respond to that because I'm coming here as a transport expert in terms of this particular issue. Obviously, there is a wider constellation of issues around enabling people to get to transport. We know affordability is one thing, and I guess affordability can be addressed by the cost basis of the provision of the service, but also wider aspects of wider support that can be given to families as well. I feel uncomfortable. I come here as a transport planner.
Okay, I'm going to ask transport questions. Don't you worry, Mr Finch. We'll do it in a second. Mr White, would you be slightly more bold than Mr Finch?
like Paul, I'm here to address transport issues. What I can say is that part of the solutions to the issues that we're addressing today are around making buses more affordable, and another aspect of that is increasing the money in everyone's pocket. But in terms of your particular question, I can't really be pressed further than that.
But you confirm that income is a key aspect, not just price. Income is a key aspect.
The more money people have, the less onerous it might be to pay a cost, be that travel or any other cost. That's clear, but my ability to comment on how we generate that income for people is limited as a transport.
Okay, I felt the need to ask that question. Let's look at some of the specifics of affordability. There are some decent work taking place by the UK government in relation to this. So for my unionist colleagues, I'm not trying to make a party political point here. There's other things I want to say. So Job Centre Plus, for example, have the travel discount card for those seeking employment, and in some cases for maybe the first month once they get into employment. There's a partnership deal with ScotRail which can give the first month's rail travel for free once parents get into employment. I know that there's also the flexible support fund that they have. So there's a mix of stuff there. The Scottish Government's got the Parental Employability Support Fund, which can pay towards transport costs. And Fair Start Scotland have a role to play there as well. And there's also a £74 million community bus fund. Now, why have I listed all of these? Well, because I want to make sure that witnesses here think that the money that is in the system, so the money that the UK government should be paying to support out-of-work parents into employment to make that sustainable, and those parents in part-time employment pick up more hours and get into full-time employment with a career progression, the money that's there for that and the money that the Scottish Government's also putting into this, is it being used together strategically? Because maybe not enough money, but there's still quite a lot of money whirling about the system here. Is it being used strategically and effectively? Maybe that's something Mr. Finch has a view on.
Thank you very much. I think in my written submission, I made the point that probably out with core urban areas, then for many people, public transport isn't an option. Because if you're a working, if you're a parent who is working, you need a certain level of viability and frequency of a public transport service to enable you to access childcare, access work, get back from work, get to the childcare, get back to home, work out your shopping. And I believe, from my experience, that the public transport offering is very limited for a majority of areas, of the majority of geographic areas outside Scotland, outside the main built-up areas, that actually is not it's a very difficult task without a private car to achieve.
That's a very valid answer, but it's not an answer to the question I asked. Earlier on, you were talking about affordability and cost. My question was about the money we're putting into the system to support affordability and cost, and you quite rightly want to talk about, which will come up later in this evidence session, I'm absolutely sure, about the rural transport offer, whether it is fit for purpose for working families and those trying to get into work. I'm asking about the money already in the system, whether via the DWP or via the Scottish Government, whether or not you think that's been used strategically well enough.
And I would say that for a lot of parts...
In relation to affordability.
OK. Could I come back on this one, please? Is that the point about affordability becomes moot if there isn't a viable service to spend it. So yes, where you have that service available, these things are welcome and strategic. They are complicated. There is a range of different things you have to go hoop through to achieve that. But for many areas, it is not strategic because it is not achieving its aims because, not because of affordability, but because of the more fundamental point, is that you don't have an option to get to work unless you have access to a private car. And I think that is actually a very fundamental consideration in terms of the question that you asked, because strategically, you can have all these interventions, but they're not having the impact that you want to achieve.
But Mr. Finch, we've just spent 10, 15, 20 minutes talking about affordability, and it wasn't a moot point we were answering the other questions. I agree with everything you've said, Mr. Finch. I absolutely agree with that. Other MSPs will ask questions absolutely about that, and you can put all of that on the record, and I'll support you when you put it on the record. I totally get that, but that's not the question I asked. One more effort to ask the question. If you don't want to answer it, that's okay. I'm not trying to be rude. I'm just trying to elicit some information that would be helpful to the committee in this inquiry. Is the money that the DWP uses, remember that the inquiry is about child poverty and parental employment and how transport plays a role in relation to that, is the money the DWP uses, is the money the Scottish Government uses, is that been used strategically well enough, in your view? It's a reasonable question.
I would say no, because of the point I've previously made.
I don't think that is an answer, but Mr. White, do you have anything to add?
I would say, is the money being used strategically well enough? Probably not. There's an argument you could say, well, there may be local solutions, so having pots of money locally to the better understand the local issues is positive. But is there a joined up look at all a spend across Scotland and is it all pushing in the same direction? I think that's something that is lacking and maybe something that will be addressed in the Fair Fares Review. You mentioned the Community Bus Fund. Again, that's also fairly unclear. I mean, I've heard the term Community Bus Fund, you'd think the title it's going to be used to improve community bus links to help people who are in poverty. The understanding of it I have of it is that it's money that can be used for local authorities to pay consultants to look at the powers within the Transport Act. So that's not exactly delivering its title. So I think they're piecemeal at the moment. We could do with a joined-up approach, but that's not a criticism of any one of those the scheme, the work of the DWP, because I'm sure it delivers good results.
And I'm not suggesting, as I actually mentioned when I bring Mr Hogg in, it's the partnership between DWP and ScotRail that I'm interested in. Now, personally, I think 1 month's free travel's welcome for rail travel. I don't think it goes far enough. It could be extended to bus travel as well for those just into employment who are working parents whose children are in poverty. That's what this inquiry is about, convener. Perhaps it could be for 6 months or 3 months fully free, 3 months tapered to 50% support. There could be a more substantive offer. It could be a partnership between ScotRail, between the bus companies, between the UK government, between the Scottish government. I'm trying to think how we deliver something substantive and meaningful that actually drives change for the people that I represent, rather than just talking about things. Mr Hogg, do you have any views on that?
Affordability is the key as far as I'm concerned. You know, I certainly believe, as I touched on earlier, transport plays a very important part in getting people to work. And the Scottish Government's own strategy in tackling child poverty, which is called Best Start, Bright Futures, is certainly welcome. As far as the RMT is concerned, can the Scottish Government do more? Absolutely. I believe that the Scottish Government can do way more. Is it a step in the right direction in terms of what the Scottish Government is doing at this moment in time? Yes.
Okay, final question then, and I suppose it's Mr Hogg, because Mr Finch and Mr White can't speak for individual bus operators or the workforce, but Mr Hogg can talk about from a years of experience about the workforce within the railways. One of the issues we want is trains that run later or start earlier or more frequently, and that all does come down to cost, but also comes down to supporting workers in relation to their paying conditions to support some of that. Has there been discussions between ScotRail and RMT, for example, about how we do run trains a bit earlier or a bit later in a way that is affordable, given quite rightly there will be additional staff costs to that, but have we started to think about how we can reshape the railways to be more responsive to that kind of thing, to support child poverty and parental employment, for example?
Continuous discussions, Bob, in relation to more resources within Scotland's trains, you know, because the harsh reality is there is not enough resources as things stand in terms of Scotland's trains. The suggestion, as things stand, to run more trains earlier or later is not possible. And if you take, a good example, Sunday not being part of the working week, where Sunday is very much reliable on the staff, existing staff, working the overtime. And that's the elephant in the room, so far as ScotRail, Transport Scotland and the Scottish Government is concerned, is to address Sunday not being part of the working week and more resources in place. If we have more resources in place, Sunday part of the working week, I'm absolutely convinced with good industrial relations, we will be able to deliver more earlier trains and more later trains.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thanks, Bob. I'm now going to bring in Jeremy. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning again. I suppose I just want to move on slightly, if that's okay, in regard to where we are. At the end of COVID, support funds affected the availability and affordability of bus services. With that support fund now gone, what has been the impact of that, both for rural communities and urban communities? And Paul, could perhaps start with you. Paul White, sorry.
Thank you. Yes, so the impacts of the pandemic are still impacting almost public transport. Patronage is down rail, down in bus. Costs are there, so there's a gap. In England and Wales, there is still a level of continued support to help bridge that gap. In Scotland, that support ended at the end of the previous financial year, and there has been an impact on fares and services, given that there had to be a reaction to the removal of that support to allow the network, the wider network, to remain commercially sustainable. So fares have increased, as have many other products that we all purchase daily, and services. Lots of areas may have only seen reductions in frequencies, but where services have been cut, that's always very emotive and it's always felt very keenly, and it's something we would ideally like to avoid.
And just to push that slightly, is there a marked differential between rural communities and urban city communities, or is it a similar picture across the whole of Scotland?
I would say that provision of transport in rural areas is challenging. That's not just across Scotland, that's across the UK and wider. You are facing fewer people who use the bus. The costs are high in terms of fuel and journey length. And that makes many of those services marginal in terms of their viability. So a removal of a support grant such as NSG Plus, the Network Support Grant Plus, that was the COVID support for the sector, it will have a larger bearing on those marginal services that are largely rural.
Paul Finch, I don't know if you've got anything to add.
Yeah, in the northeast of Scotland, there has been a significant impact, I think, in terms of that change. There was a significant impact for operators with the impacts of COVID and the changing of travel patterns and people's reluctance actually to get back on the bus, which has been noted. So the tier one services, the mainline bus services, what we've seen is fares increases and just the clipping of the operating days, reductions in frequency, say from a 15-minute down to a 20-25-minute frequency. So still viable, but there's been that diminution of service. Then there's the tier two services, which perhaps were commercial or commercially in part subsidised. They've been hit. Perhaps the routes that have been shortened, or perhaps some of those routes have been withdrawn. And then we have the tier three, perhaps the ones that wholly subsidise services, and they've been affected by some of the wider issues related to local authority revenue availability for discretionary funding as well. So my head of service at Aberdeenshire Council akin it to almost a commercial collapse of the bus service and having to make significant impacts into support some of these services, because without that, you know, there would have been towns without buses, which in living memory would never have been thought about as well. So there are significant impacts in certain parts of Scotland, and some of that pressure is then being transferred onto local authorities in terms of their revenue to continue almost like a lifeline availability of bus services in some of these areas as well.
Okay. Mr. Hogg, I don't know if you've got anything to add to that.
Just to briefly add, COVID clearly had a massive impact in terms of the income coming into Scotland's railway in order to sustain Scotland's railway. No fares were obviously taken throughout the height of the pandemic, and people, believe it or not, like say, felt, I'm talking about passengers, felt that using Scotland's railway was free of charge. And to actually convince them after the pandemic was over that they needed to start paying in order to use Scotland's railway was an absolute challenge, and still a challenge in order to get people out of their cars, out of the buses, and using Scotland's trains. And it's still a challenge.
Thank you. The Deputy Convener has said, you know, we are here to look at particularly child poverty. And I'm just wondering, what is the effectiveness of subsidising buses? Is that a way of helping in regard to the whole issue of people getting to work or getting to school around employability? Yeah, Paul.
There clearly has to be a review of rural transport provision and looking at the technologies and the different ways that we provide services to help people to address child poverty, amongst other issues, that might be impacting those living in rural areas. Over the last 5 years, commercial mileage has dropped by 7%. Subsidised mileage, that supported by local authorities, has dropped by 34%. So the commercial sector has had challenges and has made cuts, but local authorities have also had severe challenges in budget constraints and have had to look at their supported bus budgets and make cuts as well. So in that context, where money is tight across the board, how do we provide those transport links? So that's when aspects like demand responsive transport and community transport may play a role. How do we look at new solutions to link people to maybe key bus corridors where they can then shift from a community bus onto a transport hub where they can get the train or a interurban bus? So it's that. Those are the kind of things that we need to look at.
Yeah, I wonder if I could just follow up slightly. I mean, obviously, Edinburgh is the best place to live, and obviously, Edinburgh has a. I'm not sure what it's. And obviously, Edinburgh buses are probably the best service that we have anywhere in Scotland. It's obviously owned by the three local authorities, but it makes a profit. I suppose my question is, if Edinburgh can do it, why can't other cities do it?
Sarah Boyd, who's the managing director of Lothian Buses, speaks well on this. If you're looking for other witnesses for this panel, that I would recommend. She would recognise that Lothian Buses is a fantastic company and they do things very, very well. They have, they do work as a commercial operator. They make a profit, but they have the benefit of the demographics of Edinburgh. So compared to Glasgow, there's no suburban rail network. So in Glasgow, a lot of people, I'm from Glasgow, I live on the south side, I'd probably use a train to get to access the city centre, whereas in Edinburgh, most people use the bus. So you've got a larger market in terms of that. There's no competing rail network. There's a network of bus lanes through Edinburgh that assists bus provision that is lacking in other cities. You also have car parking charges that probably actually reflect the true cost of the car to the local environment, which is something that other places may not have. In Glasgow, you've got a series of large car parks surrounding the city centre where you can access quite cheaply. It's not cheap to bring your car into the centre of Edinburgh. So there, yes, Lothian Bus is a fantastic company, but there's other factors that lead to the success of that municipal operation. And I could point to municipal operations in other areas of the country where they have... they've essentially ceased to operate because of challenges. So it's not that municipal operation is the panacea.
OK.
I believe Bob just wants to come in with a supplementary there.
My apologies, yeah.
Just, it was a really, really interesting question from Mr Balfour. Obviously, I'm a Glasgow MSP, Mr White, and obviously the Cathcart Circle or the Maryhill Line in the north of the city. There is competition between that suburban rail network and buses. I'm not clear whether regional transport authorities or the bus companies or ScotRail complement each other and trying to be strategic in how they kind of work in partnership in relation to that. Is that a systemic issue, or are there examples where the rail network and the bus companies are working properly in strategic partnership? Because I would recognise it in part of my constituency where there's a poor bus service because it becomes less profitable because rail mops up part of that, but the rail is still a vital service locally.
I'm from the Cathcart area, so I know that well. So I think that the creation of the bus network and the creation of the rail network have been exercises taken separately. There are opportunities for... looking at that, the fuller picture of public transport for provision across the city region or the wider, is a role for regional transport partnerships. Yes, I think there's been some work in Glasgow there. I forget the name of the document, but essentially looking at the mobility plan more widely across the region. But yes, so it's a relationship where we are both two aligned in terms of providing sustainable transport links, but there is a degree of a rail passenger. Somebody moving from bus to rail has an impact on bus and vice versa.
And can I ask Mr Finch, this does relate to rural transport where there may be gaps in the service, perhaps even more vital to get that coordination between rail hubs and lifeline bus routes. Does that partnership work in more rural parts of the country?
Thanks for the question. Can I just... There's one thing that just I noted when we were discussing this. There was this... In my written submission, I was quite clear when I talked about the strength of public transport in core urban areas. I would highlight that increasingly it is almost some suburban areas that are struggling now as well. So it's not just rural areas. I would say that there's in some urban... So sometimes when we talk about urban and rural, actually I live in a settlement on the edge of Aberdeen, which you might thought, well, that can sustain a bus service, but that bus service is actually subsidised. I'm only 4 or 5 miles from the centre of Aberdeen. So when we talk about that rural definition of subsidised services or not, I think traditionally we've always thought about small villages and rural areas, but increasingly, because of some of the pressures I noted before, it is that level of viability is sometimes closer to urban areas than you might necessarily say. So that's one point. I'm coming back to a point that was made earlier. There is a lot of work that could be improved in terms of how we could get the bus network and the rail network to work better. The levers that the public sector have to achieve that, though, unless there is a franchised system, are relatively limited, because the system for the majority of Scotland is based on the 1985 Transport Act and on the presumption of commercial operators making the best choices of what they want to do. So as a regional transport authority, which does not have those powers, it is quite difficult to influence and dictate to, say, Stagecoach or someone like that, yes, you will be running feeder services into, say, Kintore Station or Inverurie Station. Sometimes they do it because it works, but it is very difficult to mandate under the current environment that we work. There are examples of good partnership working, and there are bus partnerships, and there's the prospect of bus service improvement partnerships, which are coming down the line, and they may well provide an opportunity for that more a better joined up approach. And certainly the conversations I have with the senior managers at ScotRail, where they say, well, we have a strong rail corridor here, why can't it is to everybody's benefit if the local bus services could be redesigned to feed into that. And we did as an example where the local authority has the powers, we were in Belfast a few months ago, where it is a wholly franchise system, so the public sector has control over the buses as well as the trains. And in that environment, they were able to arrange the... In that instance, it was the glider service, which was a fast tram-like bus, rapid transit, but they were able to then deliver feeder services into that. So it is possible, there is a willingness to do it, but it may also be about that the levers that the public sector partners have to achieve that as well.
Mr. Hogg, do you want to add anything?
Yes, I would actually go a step further and say that there needs to be a better approach when it comes to our transport links approach in terms of the bus network, the rail network and the ferry network. I think these are networks that are all inextricably linked to each other, and a better approach, a better strategy we put in place would actually serve the people of Scotland a lot better.
Thank you.
Okay. I'll bring in Jeremy again.
I'm conscious of time, but just one more question, if that's okay, much around community bus fund and just any comments around the potential of using that in regard to the level of funding and how that can fit in with what we're going forward to do. Again, Paul White might want to talk about that.
Okay, we've touched on regulatory models in the last answers to the last question, and there are certainly powers in the Transport Act, and local authorities are free to investigate those. There's some good work in areas of Scotland looking at bringing together local authorities and bus operators through partnership models. Glasgow is a good example of that, where you can look at the network of services and bus, you can consider things like fares, you can consider a whole range of benefits to the network through that partnership. The Community Bus Fund seems to be driven towards allowing local authorities to employ or bring consultants to investigate the powers of the Transport Act and consider what might be a possible best solution for them further down the line. SPT has done some early work on that, looking at the costs of bringing in a franchise model to the Strathclyde region through largely Greater Glasgow, and also the timescales for the introduction of these things. So my own opinion is that the Community Bus Fund, as the name suggests, should prioritise improving bus links for communities and tackle issues such as this committee is looking at, things that are more immediate, are absolute priorities and shouldn't be invested in considering options that may take 5 to 7 years and cost lots to deliver. The truth of the matter is, whether a bus has got First or Stagecoach or any other operator's name on the side, or it has SPT's name on the side, the challenges that are affecting the costs for users are the exact same. It's congestion, it's the challenges that COVID has brought around travel patterns and things like that. None of that is resolved by who owns the bus. So I'd like to see the Community Bus Fund more directed towards targeting those type of things that allows people access to buses and that the buses are available and affordable.
I don't know if our two witnesses have anything to add to that.
Just briefly from me, it's not my gig, but certainly what I would say is a lot of fragmentation, and certainly the benchmark would clearly come over loud and clear is Lothian Buses, how to actually run a community partnership in the Lothians, which they deliver very, very well.
The Community Bus Fund, as I understand, is a capital fund, and I think the crying need is for revenue support or revenue interventions that can perhaps promote innovation in particular areas. So there is that might be a limitation as to the practical use that local authorities and others can put the money to immediately address the problems of this particular inquiry.
Thank you, Camino.
OK, thanks very much. I'm now going to bring in Paul.
Thank you very much, Convener, and I suppose just to expand on the theme that colleagues have been interrogating. The Transport Act obviously gave provision to local authorities to run services, and we've had some discussion on that already. I appreciate what Paul White said about municipality not necessarily being a panacea. We do know that, you know, local bus services in Scotland have dropped by 38% in terms of since 2007. You know, we have lost thousands of routes, and often these routes are the sort of routes that connect communities to other services, train service, but also help people in rural communities in particular get to work and access work. So I'm just interested, obviously we've had a kind of, you know, 4-year delay to getting secondary legislation to actually enable local authorities to explore, take forward much of this work. So that secondary legislation, you know, that what impact has that delay had in your view? And maybe if I can ask Paul White.
Yeah, if I could come back to you on the point around lost routes since 2007. I think that was a feature of a press release by Scottish Labour about 2 to 3 weeks ago. I've written to Mr Sarwar about that because it's based on a statistical... there was a statistical correction on the number of routes within Scotland in 2020-21 that release doesn't take account of. So prior to 2020-21, the Traffic Commissioner... would publish reports which shows the number of routes in Scotland, but some were double counted due to routes crossing local authority boundaries, so the numbers double counted some routes. In 2020-21, and I don't have the figures in front of me, but it's around about 800, so it went from the figure dropped all of a sudden from 2000 and something by 800. The figures for that year actually net, there was a drop of 40 actual routes, but the figure was readjusted for 840. So I've written to Mr Sarwar to say he hasn't recognised this statistical correction that is clear from the Traffic Commissioner's report, and that figure about losing 1,300 routes is factually is incorrect. It's about 400 since, which is not ideal.
But you would acknowledge 400, you know, is a serious issue for communities
it's not
across Scotland.
So we would like to see progress on the secondary legislation for all aspects of the transport bill. There's been delays and for good reason. I mean, the COVID has interrupted the process, and we all switched our attention to looking how we fund and operate public transport through the pandemic, when patronage levels went down below 10%. So really, we do not shy away from the discussions that might be had around the Transport Act powers, be that franchising or municipal operation or bus service improvement partnerships. But that has been delayed and will go into 2024. And so I'm sure that's a frustration that is shared with our local authority partners.
I don't know if anyone else wants to comment on that, and then I'll go on to digital demand response transport. Paul Finch.
I just say again, there is an eagerness from the local authorities to engage with the Transport Act provisions and to see where to work it through, to work, see what works for them in their particular examples, what they're trying to achieve, but also take into account their budgetary and their risk profiles as well. Around this, so and lots of authorities, those who have benefited from access to the Bus Partnership Fund, for example, are very much looking at BSIPs and franchising models at this time, and seeing the guidance and the secondary legislation come out is being welcomed, and we're keen to engage proactively with Transport Scotland officials on that particular journey.
Thank you. I opened by talking about rural issues and issues in rural transport in particular, and for many rural communities I think there's a huge issue in terms of, as I say, being able to access transport that takes you to work opportunities, opportunities for various levels of education or support. I'm keen to discuss, you know, the potential of digital demand responsive transport. Now, I think whilst it's been kind of highlighted that it shouldn't be a replacement for, you know, wider services, there is a role to play. It's had a role to play. I mean, people remember, you know, Dial-A-Bus, for example, being, you know, a feature of our transport network for some time. So I wonder if you might just comment firstly on the potential of that to support people, particularly in rural communities, who need that extra support to get to the various places that I've mentioned.
From my perspective, it's fantastic to see new technology coming in and helping. Yes, the digital demand responsive transport, the access to information the availability of a bus, being able to access a bus, being able to know the timetable or to get one, how much it's going to cost you, those type of things. The more we can provide that, the better it will help. Digital demand responsive transport, like all demand responsive transport projects, it can be quite costly to provide. That is the one factor, because you're not dealing with a number of passengers, you're not dealing with them separate. So low usage can mean, when you look at the cost per passenger journey, it can be quite high. So that can be a challenge from those types of projects. So Kickstarter funding, trying to get the thing established and get usage up to a certain level, it can be useful for it to hopefully be reach a stage where it's sustainable locally for people to use. But certainly new technology provides us opportunities to trial these type of things.
I suppose the interesting thing about that is you have to, I suppose, in a way, have access to the technology. So would you see those two things as obviously sitting quite close together? We need to deal with that digital exclusion part, as well as, you know, actually having the services available to people.
I think you're exactly right. There's two aspects to that. Do people have the technology to use it? And also there's the accessibility angle of, is it easy for people to use or read or access if they're visually impaired, if there are other accessibility issues? So we really have to take that into regard.
I wonder if I could just ask Mick about that digital piece, maybe in terms of the rail network as well, and people's ability to access those sorts of new services. I mean, do you see that as a concern for a lot of people, particularly with additional support needs, who rely on, digital, but also having human staff there to support them as well? You know, is that a kind of twin thing we need to look at?
Yes, we obviously welcome new technology. We're not dinosaurs, despite the fact that we've been accused of being dinosaurs living in the dark ages. We welcome new technology. We work very, very closely with ScotRail. We've got a good working relationship with ScotRail, the four trade unions, and we recognise part of that is new technology and accessibility to new technology is the key to Scotland's trains going forward. So we certainly welcome new technology.
Thank you. Paul, did you want to comment at all?
Yeah. The Aberdeenshire Council had recent experience of a ready-to-go scheme, which is digital demand responsive in and around the area of Inverurie, a town of about 10, 11,000 people, on 15 or so miles away from Aberdeen, looking at that area. It brought new people to the public transport market. It enabled access to employment. It enabled access to nurseries. And it helped young people get out and around. So they had the youth card, but they could actually use the youth card, no longer reliant upon their parents for doing the shuttle bus, the taxi service in these areas. However, you're buying a different product. You're not buying a fixed route, fixed time sort of bus. You're buying a more flexible product. I think the experience of Aberdeenshire was very positive. It was expensive, and unfortunately the funding was withdrawn because of the cost. However, strong lessons were learned, and I think we can see that probably across Scotland we're at a relatively immature stage at the moment, and some of the software needs to expand or mature to better serve the market. I'm very enthusiastic about digital demand responsive in rural areas. There are some legislative concerns because, as it is at the moment, you can't put it in where it might undercut or cut across a commercial operator because of the legislation, and that limits where you might effectively deploy it as well. But the experience in terms of what we're talking about in this committee was very positive in terms of achieving those objectives in those areas where there is not a strong and reliable bus service, or where the bus service runs on a particular corridor, but the actual employment and service accessibilities might be off that corridor in a variety of locations, which you might find often on market towns out with the main cities as well. So. And I believe that this is something that we should be continuing to support and to ensure that there can be a maturity of the technology to better serve the particular circumstances, recognising that it's one tool in the toolbox, and that community transport, voluntary transport, subsidised taxis are also active travel links as well, can all be part of what's in the toolbox for a particular community.
Allow Rose wants to come in with a commentary.
Literally just a little point, because you're talking about a specific example that's happening just outside Aberdeen, which it sounds great, and it certainly fits into previous evidence that you've given to us today about fitting in with people's lives, because it's a little bit more user-friendly, shall we say. But your concern was funding stopped. Well, the funding stopped, so the whole process stopped. Is it because it was not commercially viable? Is it because of the different concerns there was of overcutting or going past or getting in the way of different transport models? Or was it primarily just the fact that it just was never going to stand on its own two feet and it's not going to happen?
The digital demand responsive transport, and there's a wonderful report that Como UK have done with Transport Scotland on this, which I commend to the committee in terms of providing that overview. Very rarely will that ever be commercially viable. It will always be subsidised. I would note that the majority of Scotland's railways is subsidised as well. Aberdeenshire Council have a budget of around 3.2 million for their bus network per annum. This was costing an additional £470,000 per annum on top of the fixed bus route, and then there were pressures on that budget from other, like I said, making sure that all towns across Aberdeenshire had access to a bus. So it was something that the local authority at that point couldn't withstand, despite the positive and beneficial outcomes that it had in achieving accessibility and widening the availability and affordability of transport to particularly marginalised groups who perhaps didn't have access for whatever reason to a private car.
So to summarise, just to make sure I've got it all right, it, as far as the remit of what we're looking for and getting people back, parents back into work and doing the looking at child poverty, it's an avenue that may actually work as long as the funding process is there.
Yes, and I would say
thank you.
It, people respond over time to the certainty. So if they see it as a pilot service, or will it be there, will it be not, there's a nervousness about taking it up. So sometimes it's about that longer term commitment that can help. But sometimes you have to have that learning experience as well, chicken and egg sort of situation.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Paul.
And I'll bring Paul back in.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, I think it's on those points about how we sustainably support these services to be to offer additionality in terms of the core services that we would see across bus, rail, etc. You know, a lot of community transport organisations, Paul Finch mentioned community transport, you know, do an excellent job of additionality, but actually struggle in terms of, you know, funding and sustainability of funding. So I suppose it's a question about those digital responsive services and those community services. I mean, do we need to see them become much more involved in the kind of mainstream funding rather than just being perhaps pilot innovations that don't command confidence?
I think it would be really good to see that evolution because of what we have seen in the last few years about the mainline public transport network, that there is this need across many areas of Scotland which are crying out for support so people can get around and not be wholly reliant on the car, because the problem is people are now being forced car dependents and they're having to run a car and not feed their families just so they can get around the situation. So there needs to be a solution, and this seems to offer one way of doing it, and it would be really good to see the Fares Fair review and some of these other initiatives extend their remit, or at least consider how this can be made an appropriate technique, instead of some of these really great organisations living almost hand to mouth in terms of year to year allocations of funding, help to address the voluntary nature of some of their stuff, and actually perhaps start investing in low decarbonisation of their options as well.
Thank you, Gavin.
Okay, thanks very much. And I want to thank all our witnesses for taking part and sharing your expertise today. We will conclude taking evidence on the inquiry next week with a session with the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, the Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing Economy, Fair Work and Energy, the Minister for Children, Young People and Keeping the Promise, and the Minister for Education. So that concludes our public business. Next week, we will hold our final evidence session of the inquiry with Scottish Government Cabinet Secretaries and Ministers, and we'll also hear from the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice about other priorities relevant to this committee. We will now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda, and I'd like to thank our witnesses once again. Thank you.